Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is Thursday, March 29th, 2018. Today is Monday, Thursday. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Tomorrow on Good Friday, we have services at 2 o'clock and 7. On Sunday, Easter Sunday, April 1st, services are at 8 and 10:30. There is an Easter breakfast from 9 to 10:15, and with an Easter egg hunt during the time of breakfast.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors and ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Holy God, source of all love, on the night of his betrayal, Jesus gave us a new command, to love one another as he loves us. Write this commandment in our hearts, and give us a will to serve others as he was servant of all, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We now listen to the reading of God's Word.
Connie Singleton will be doing the readings.
Good The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month, they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roasted over the fire with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until the morning, you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Let us pray. God of mercy and compassion, through the passion and resurrection of your Son, you have freed us from the bonds of sin and death. Be with us in our pilgrimage, that we may offer you a sacrifice of thanksgiving, fulfill our vows, and glorify you in the presence of all your people. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The second reading is from 1 Corinthians. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Tonight, we are faced with an interesting dilemma. Jesus is in the upper room with his disciples to celebrate Passover. And as he is doing so, he knows what is going to take place that evening and on the next day. Yet he first sets an example to his disciples and to us by washing their feet. A practice or a duty that was given to the lowest slave in a house or to the youngest child. Yet here Jesus is showing us an example of service and humility. Then Jesus institutes, as he's celebrating the Passover, what we know as the Lord's Supper, the sacrament of the altar. And in this, we see Jesus giving thanks. Even though he knows, as he is passing around the bread and the cup, that Judas is going to betray him as soon as this is over. And yet we still have the thanks of Jesus in this institution of this most important activity of the church, the Lord's Supper. So to see these thanks of Jesus, we leave our gospel lesson and go back to our second lesson from that first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. For St. Paul is speaking to the Corinthians about the Lord's Supper, the sacrament of the altar, and he is actually admonishing them or scolding them because in that congregation, the sacrament is being abused. It is almost turning into a drunken party. Those who are wealthy go ahead and eat and celebrate, and those who are less wealthy are left out. And so St. Paul is reminding him what this sacrament is all about. So as we pick up with verse 23, he says, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you." Jesus, or St. Paul, did not receive what Jesus says from one of the other apostles. He tells us three times in Acts about how after being blinded on the road to Damascus and going to the street called Straight and being baptized by Ananias, that he went out for a time of solitude, and at this time the resurrected Lord Jesus once again appeared to him and gave to him the gospel and appointed him or called him to be the apostle to the Gentiles. So he says, "For I received from the Lord," that is directly, "and so I delivered this to you just as the Lord told it to me." The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. So the first thanks of Jesus we see is his giving thanks for the bread that he is about to distribute. The word thanks means to be grateful. Here Jesus is at the beginning of his passion, and yet he still is grateful to God for what God has called him to do. He knows that what lies before him is the horrible pain of the cross, and yet he is grateful to God that he has been chosen or sent to earth to be the salvation of the world. The word also has the meaning of saying grace before me. And as we see see Jesus' example. I just wonder how many Christians today have fallen out of the practice of saying grace before they eat. Whether it's breakfast, lunch, or supper at home, or whether they are having a meal out. If they take time, I don't mean make a big display, because Jesus tells us when we make a big display in public praying, we've already received our reward. But when you go out to eat, you can simply bow your head unobtrusively and say a prayer of thanks before you eat. But this evening, this thanks is being grateful. He knows what is going to transpire, and he still gives thanks, even as he, by his actions and words, are foreshadowing his upcoming death. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you." That term, "which is for you," means to be on behalf of our need. In other words, Jesus is saying, "I am doing this for you and for those who will come after you who believe in me. I'm not doing this for myself." Because Jesus didn't need it. He was already the Son of God. He's doing it for us because it's our need. What was our need? Salvation. Who gives us salvation? Jesus. What was our other need? He's talking about the need to be spiritually refreshed, week by week in our faith, by receiving his body and blood at the Lord's table to reassure us of the forgiveness of sin and the promise of everlasting life. That is the purpose, to be our spiritual food. Just as we need physical food for our bodies, we need spiritual food. We need the Word, of course. That is the main spiritual food, but we need the Lord's Supper. To gather together in fellowship, to partake of the body and blood of Christ, not only to have that reassurance, but also to remember him and what he did for us. To not take it for granted. "Do this in remembrance of me," he says. The word translated as remembrance means to recall something, to call something to mind with affection. It also means to be a memorial or a commemoration. But when we celebrate the Lord's Supper, yes, we are commemorating his death on the cross. Yes, we are remembering the great sacrifice he made for us. But we also are recalling to mind with affection what he did for us, and that he is our friend, he is our big brother, he is our trailblazer, who has blazed the trail to salvation through faith in what he has done. And so he calls upon us to remember this. But the Lord's Supper is not just a memorial. It's not just because the Passover was strictly a memorial. The Passover of the Jews was a time when they remembered their deliverance out of bondage in Egypt through Moses, the sending of Moses and Aaron, to challenge Pharaoh or to command Pharaoh to let my people go, speaking on behalf of God. But each year that was it. It's just done once a year, and it's just a remembrance. The Lord's Supper is done frequently. Our confessions actually say it's supposed to be done every Sunday and whenever Mass is celebrated. And it is done not just to remember Jesus' sacrifice, but to be nourished spiritually by his body and blood. So as he said, the bread is his body. And he is giving thanks to the Father that he will give up his body to save us from sin, death, and the power of the devil. Now, we have something here that has caused confusion among some people. And that is when Jesus, or when St. Paul tells us, as he had given thanks, speaking of the bread, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you." Some people are, for some reason, confused the breaking of the bread with Jesus' sacrifice. And there have been those who mistakenly have said with this truth, coming to the host, to bread, have said, the body of Christ broken for you. Now that totally contradicts Scripture, because Scripture tells us Jesus' body was not broken. In the 19th chapter of the Gospel according to St. John, John's account of the crucifixion, he tells us how, because the Sabbath was rapidly approaching and the chief priests and the Pharisees did not want the bodies to be hanging on the cross once the Sabbath began, because it was a special Sabbath, being the Sabbath of Passover. And so the soldiers came to break the criminals' legs so that would speed up their death. They no longer would be able to support themselves, and once their legs were broken, their bodies would just collapse straight in against the nails and ropes, their lungs would collapse, they would no longer be able to get a breath of air, and they would quickly die. And so it says they came to the first criminal and broke his legs, they came to the second criminal and broke his legs, and when they came to Jesus, they discovered that Jesus was already dead. And so a soldier took his spear and pierced Jesus' side. And then John tells us this was to fulfill the scriptures which said, not a bone of my body shall be broken, which is Psalm 34:20. And they looked upon him whom they had pierced, which is the prophecy of Zechariah 12:10. And so Jesus' body, I don't know where this ever came from, that Jesus' body was broken. It was not broken. Just like the Passover lamb had to be pure and spotless. It couldn't have any broken legs. It couldn't have any spots on it. It couldn't have any blemishes. It couldn't have any place where, like, a patch of its wool was missing because of some kind of scraping against briars and bushes or getting in a fight with a wild animal that bit it and took out. It had to be a perfect lamb. Jesus had to be the perfect sacrifice, meaning not a body, but not a bone could be broken. And the payment was his blood that he shed upon that cross. So you do not say, this is the body of Christ broken for you. You say what Jesus says to you, this is my body given for you. Or in St. Paul's version, which is for you. This is my body which is for you. So that's the first thing Jesus gives thanks for, is for the bread, which is his body in the sacrament, which sacrifice for us for salvation. Next, Jesus gives thanks for the cup. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. This is the new covenant. That word means fresh. Means something that's not like before. It's not the old covenant with Noah. It's not the old covenant with Abraham. It's not the covenant made through the lawgiver Moses with the Hebrew children, Mount Sinai, after they were freed from their bondage in Egypt. This is a new covenant. A new covenant between God and his people so that we might be his own and live under him in his kingdom. The word covenant means a contract. Or it means a testament. So this is a new contract between God and us. It's a new contract between God and the world. Because Jesus' death is for all people. No matter what their nationality, no matter what their race, creed, or color, no matter what religion they may be following now, or following no religion, his death still is for them, and they receive the benefits once they hear the call to the gospel and believe and confess that Jesus is Lord. The word means testament, like the last will and testament. This is Jesus' last will and testament, so we have no power to change it. He told us what to do. He told us how to do it. And we don't change it. Because it's his last will and testament. Just like you write a will and have it authorized, and when you pass away, then your ears will hear the will read, and whatever you say in that will, they can't change. I don't know how many of you saw the Clint Eastwood movie Gran Torino, but if you did, you remember the scene at the end where Clint Eastwood's character, it has a Christ theme to it, as Clint Eastwood sacrifices himself to protect this Hmong people that he's encountered, his neighbors that he's become really good friends with, and it gets this Hmong gang all arrested so they're no longer terrorizing the neighborhood. But anyhow, he's reading, the lawyer's reading his last will and testament, and he comes to the final clause, which is about his Gran Torino. He had this beautiful Gran Torino that was in top shape, and he had worked for Ford. If you didn't know the movie, he had been a worker at Ford for 30, 40 years on the island. He made Gran Torinos. It was one of the last cars he made. So he had one that was in excellent shape. Well, the granddaughter looks at her dad, and they smile back and forth because they think she's going to receive it. But instead, he gives it to the little Hmong fellow who lived next door, whom he had become very good friends with. And when the lawyer reads that, you see the expression on the father and daughter's face. They can't believe it. Well, they can't believe it, but they can't do anything about it. Because it's Clint's last will and testament. That is the same with Jesus. We can't change the Lord's Supper. We can't substitute the bread and the wine. He was celebrating Passover. And that is what you use in the celebration of Passover. So you can imagine my horror when I was talking to a youth pastor from a non-liturgical church. And he was telling me how he was having a youth weekend retreat, and they were going to have communion. And instead of bread and wine, he was going to substitute Coke and potato chips. His excuse being, well, that's what Jesus would do if he were around today. I just looked at him for a good hard minute or so, just staring at him. I said, do you have any idea what Jesus was doing the night he instituted the Lord's Supper? I said, he wasn't having a party. He wasn't trying to be cool. I said, he was a Jew. A devout Jew celebrating Passover, which with the Day of Atonement are the two most important festivals in the Jewish religion. I said, and he used wine and unleavened bread because that's what they do at Passover. And that's what they were commanded to do by God when they celebrated the first Passover. So likewise, we as Christians were told by Jesus to use bread and wine, which becomes his body and blood. So you don't substitute Coke and potato chips. It just went right over his head. Because he had no understanding of sacramental theology. He had no understanding of the sacrificial death of Jesus Christ. Just like in Griffith when I was there, every Good Friday we'd have a joint Good Friday service at around noon. One year we had an Assembly of God church. And we walk in, and the platform where we were going to stand was lined with lilies, Easter lilies. This was Good Friday. You know, the Catholic priest, the Episcopalian priest, myself, the Methodist pastor, or two, we just all looked at each other like, you don't put Easter lilies out for Good Friday. But they didn't have a concept of a Good Friday, because they never celebrated it. This was the first time they celebrated that church, because we moved it around to each church that was big enough to hold it. They came to Griffith the next year, and they walk in, and the cross is draped in black, and everything else is covered in black, and it's like totally different understanding. So this is Jesus' last will, and he says to drink this cup because it's my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sin. And as Scripture teaches us, where there is the forgiveness of sins, there is everlasting life. So Jesus is giving thanks that through what is going to happen to him in the next 24, 36, whatever hours, that this is going to bring this new contract between us and God for our salvation. No more animal sacrifices, no more law and ritual, forgiveness and eternal life in the blood of Jesus. And then the last thanks of Jesus we see is he gives thanks for the promise of his second coming. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. The word proclaim means to tell openly and loud. It means to declare something for all to hear. Jesus Christ, who died and rose, will come again. And the Lord's Supper reminds us of that promise each time we celebrate. Each time we come to the Lord's table, we come and have a direct meeting with our friend and big brother, Jesus Christ. Nearly 600 years ago, in Westminster Abbey, in England, Henry V, King of England at the time. This was before the Reformation, so it was still just the Roman Catholic Church in the West, in Western Europe, and in the new lands that were being discovered by the Spanish and French and others. And one day, one of his servants or ministers, whatever, found him not in the main nave, which was filled overflowing, as people were listening to a young, talented preacher preach the gospel, but he was in a side chapel receiving the Lord's Supper with just a couple of other people. And this minister, whatever he was, meaning not clergy, but like minister of finance or minister of taxes or whatever, he said, "Why are you here and not out of the nave?" And he said, his answer was, "I would rather meet with my friend than hear someone talk about my friend." Now, of course, preaching is important to proclaim the word to the world. Bible study is important. Sunday school is important. Reading your Bible is important. Witnessing to others is important. Important way for us to evangelize. But when we come to the Lord's table, we are meeting face to face as our friend. For the one who did everything for us so that we might have eternal life. And so the Lord's Supper, the sacrament of the altar, is more than just eating and drinking. It's more than just remembering. It is confessing and believing that Jesus Christ is Lord. It is confessing and believing in the death of Jesus Christ on the cross, paying the debt of sin that we owe. There is nothing we can do for our salvation. Jesus has done it all. And because he rose on that third day and ascended 40 days later and waits to return in glory, we confess and proclaim that good news to others. So this is why, that night in the upper room, Jesus was giving thanks. The thanks of Jesus was for the fact that he was now fulfilling the mission for which he was sent, to be that sacrifice so that we might be his forever in his kingdom. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Let us now sing "Go to Dark Gethsemane," hymn number 347, in the back of your worship book, hymn number 347.
today is hear our prayer. Holy Lord, since your Son taught us that as often as we eat his bread and drink his cup, we proclaim his death until he comes, use every such proclamation of Christ to turn those without faith to trust in the Passover Lamb who offered himself for our salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy Lord, we remorsefully confess that we are prone to stray. Guard and defend each of us from the temptations of the devil, the world, and our own sinful inclinations. Forgive our sins, strengthen our faith, and keep us as your own until you bring us to feast with angels, archangels, and all your saints at your heavenly table. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy Lord, as your Son washed his disciples' feet and then offered himself in service by going to the cross, give us humble hearts that are ready always to serve our families, our friends, our communities, and even our enemies, caring for everyone in your name, using our lives to do your will. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Holy Lord, answer our prayers for those who are sick, suffering, dying, and grieving. Since your Son suffered as we do, and since you know our needs far better than we do, give to each of them and each of us your gracious care. Show your mercy to everyone in need. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy Lord, Christ entered the most holy place once for all by his own blood. He has redeemed us and inaugurated your new covenant. Teach us to examine ourselves so that confessing our sins, we come in repentance to receive our Savior's body and blood. By those gifts that you place in our mouths at this altar, give us Christ's forgiveness and renew us in faith. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Holy Lord, as we enjoy communion in the one bread and one cup of your Son's body and blood, unite us with each other and with all those who have gone before us in the faith, and feed us with your life so that we serve you and love one another as our Messiah loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we place ourselves and offer, we pray, confident of the mercy that you show to us because of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. St. John practices an open communion. For all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior, who believe his body and blood are truly present as we gather at his table, in our communion age and in your own individual congregation, we invite and encourage you to come forward with us as not, As we gather at the table, we continue our celebration with a great thanksgiving on page 107 in the front of your worship book. The Lord be with you. Christ given for you. The body of 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 Christ given for you. By the name of Jesus, take the tip and bless us, that child we should always be thinking. Spirit. Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, say, protect and bless us, that child may surely speak and care of you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The body of Christ given for you. 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 Please stand. By the Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood, strengthen and preserve your true faith and the life eternal. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, in a wonderful sacrament, you strengthen us in the saving power of your suffering, death, and resurrection. May this sacrament of your body and blood so work in us that the fruits of your redemption will show forth in the way we live, that you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. You may be seated. Ask that you turn to Psalm 51 and sing the song as Easter.
Thank you.
This concludes the Monday-Thursday service.